told me from the start that you played around and would have been fine. Then I would have played too, and I guess I would have had a good time. If you told me from the start that you played around and would have been fine, then I would have played too, and I guess I would have had a good time.
Hello, I am Vincent-Tennell, and you are watching The Vincent-Tennell Show. Today, we have a returning guest here with us, the always colorful Dr. Kemau. How are you doing today?
Doing fine. How about you?
I'm so good, and I'm surprised you even wanted to come back.
Why not?
Because we kind of had a rough ending the last time we spoke.
That's what communication is about.
All right.
It's going to be a rocky road sometime, but you have to get from one end to the other.
We're going
to
get it right this time. So this time, we actually wanted to get to know more about you versus just talking about topics as we did before, because you have been a staple in our community for years, and people just want to know, who is the man behind the controversial topics about you?
Well, I'd say I'm just an average person. I'm a competitive person. I love to play cards and dominoes, you know, Midwest. I like sports. Love to read, love people.
So what
I
you
like
reading?
Little people, like kids. What am I reading
now?
I'm rereading Temple of My Familiar by Alice Walker. That's one. I have a book that I want to read by a friend. I'm a science fiction junkie, so I'm usually reading four or five books at the same time. So I'm reading a piece of sci-fi, you know, junk. Between the World and Me is next on my reading list.
You know what? I heard about that book. That was suggested to me.
Me too.
So maybe we can read it together and you can give me your insight and I can give you mine.
Sounds good.
So I want to know, what is the greatest misconception about Dr. Kemau?
Apparently I intimidate some people. I've been told that. I don't know why. I'm actually approachable, but like I said, with communication, it takes some give and take sometimes. So if I can give it out, I can take it. So I want to interact with people the way that they might want to interact with me. And nothing is lost if we have a negative start, as you thought we did.
No, we did. I mean, why would people be scared to approach you? If that's the conception you're putting out, what are you doing to compensate? What are you working to change that?
Well, a lot of people are intimidated by an intelligent black man, one who speaks his mind, one who doesn't agree with the mainstream. And that's part of what it is. But I have certain kind of standards. If I don't understand what somebody's talking about, I'll ask them to clarify what they mean. Mm-hmm. And since I usually give answers that people don't expect to the questions that they may ask, sometimes they don't want to ask questions. They just choose to back off and avoid what might be seen as a controversy. Mm-hmm. But that's how people learn to me.
Now, if we're being honest, do you think sometimes you do that on purpose? You go out of your way to be difficult?
No.
You don't?
It's just a natural personality. That's how I am.
Okay. Do you think a controversial person is made, or do you become that way over time?
The nature nurture. It's a little bit of both. You know, for me, I was reading sixth grade level in like kindergarten. So the intelligence or whatever was there, the sense of asking questions. See, I never bothered any of my teachers. I sat in class reading almost all the time. Teachers would call on me and I'd answer the question correctly.
You give me a Kanye West vibe. A little bit of arrogancy, a little bit of ego.
I don't know.
Do you think that comes along with the territory when it comes to black academia? Because I hear that a lot. You know, people who are highly intelligent kind of look down over other people who aren't on their level.
That's where the misconception comes. It's not a thing of looking down. But I enjoy... And actually, one of my next books is going to deal with a lot of that. I will talk with anyone. I will interact with anyone. I've washed other people's toilets. So I've been in the trenches and done those kinds of jobs. And I respect people who do those jobs. So I'm just as liable to talk with them as I am with anyone else.
So you've kind of earned your stripes.
Well, in terms of the academic stuff and all of that, yeah. And I prefer to kind of know what I'm talking about. But I can talk about many different kinds of things with a lot of different people. So that's where some of the misperception is. People are often intimidated by the education. I usually don't introduce myself as Dr. Kemau. Mm-hmm. I am Dr. Kemau. I said, no, I'm Kemau.
Well, you know, going back to your childhood and upbringing, what were your parents like?
Father was a teacher.
Okay.
Come from a family of teachers. Two of his sisters were teachers. His mother worked on worked in the slaughterhouse. His father worked on a railroad in East St. Louis. My mother was a stay-at-home wife, but I'm the oldest of five kids.
Okay. Okay.
So early on, I took responsibility for, you know, my siblings and stuff.
Right.
So
I've right.
been cooking since 10 because Mom said, you know, she wasn't cooking on Sundays. She decided to take at least one day off.
Yeah. So what do you think your legacy is going to be?
I'm not sure what it is now. I want to leave a legacy in print in terms of some of the things that I write and some of the scholarship. I think my students are my legacy in many ways, but my kids. I have a couple of beautiful children, and that's probably the best legacy that I could have with respect to that.
I kind of think the whole legacy thing is overrated. Like, I think people want to live on, but why do you need to live on when other people are going to come along?
Well, other people will come along, but I think people want to be known and remembered. And in terms of looking at, this is some area of scholarship, you know, the African consciousness, you are alive as long as people know and speak your name. So your ancestors are important. So you asked who I was and what my background was like. So I talked about my parents and my grandparents. You know, so I hope that my grandkids will have a chance to talk with me when I have them. I don't have any yet.
Okay. And what is love to you?
Love is many splendored and splintered thing, to borrow some old cliche lines. You know, it depends what kind of love. Like I said, I love little kids. I love family. You know, I have defined family as people to kill or die for. So if we're looking at familial kind of love, but intense and intimate engagement. So if I say I love to dialogue or love to talk with people, that for me is what love is. It gets thrown around too much. It ends up not meaning a whole lot when people say I love you and they don't necessarily mean that that's something special, that's an ulterior motive for them saying it.
Okay. What is your greatest success in life?
Probably my children.
You know, that's cliche.
Well, like I said, I care about my kids. I mean, you know, everybody may have
everybody
a kind
says
of a
that. What's another success? Something you're proud of?
Well, at some level, the education and the things that I'm going to do. You know, I've met a number of good people from different places in the planet, and you know, in terms of my legacy and interacting with people and being known in different places, and you know, folks wanting me to come back, and you know, that kind of a thing, person-to-person interactions, you know, that mm-hmm. I've had. You know, I've been a champion in a basketball tournament. You know, that I scored the last point, so that was one of the things that I'll remember. I've hit probably a 400-foot home run at some point, and I've made that 30-foot jumper at the buzzer sort of stuff. So, you know, scored a 108-yard interception for a touchdown. And so I've had different kinds of successes in different, you know, places.
But your children are your greatest.
Yeah, I'd say my kids are probably
okay.
My greatest. I've avoided death a couple of times in what would have been real tricky car accident kinds of things. So the fact that I'm still here, I think that's a success. I've perhaps saved a couple of people's lives. You know, my one of my nieces or my cousin's child was choking, and I, in a room full of adults when I was like 17, 18, I kind of saved her. You know, feel good about that. One of my guide kids was getting ready to go under in Malibu or Venice Beach, and I ran out and jumped in and dived and pulled him out. Those kinds of things, I think, are successes and things that I've done.
What make you a hero? So what have you failed at in life?
Well, one of the reasons why I don't necessarily like doctor is I should have been an MD. You know, in my college days, I wasn't dedicated. I started out as pre-med. You know, I was kind of a savant in school, and got out in California, and a number of social things took me away from doing what I was supposed to be doing in school. So, you know, I have a PhD now, but that isn't what I plan to be. I plan to be a surgeon or a psychiatrist.
Social things like what took you away?
Primarily drugs.
Drugs?
Yeah.
So you dibbled and dabbled in some things?
No, it wasn't dibbling and dabbling at the level at which I was. I was high for about 5 years straight.
Doing what exactly?
Never shot a needle. You know, wasn't into pills, but combustibles mostly.
Okay. So let's stick to this for a minute, because we live in a generation to where drugs are glorified. So
yeah,
were they glorified during that time for you?
Yeah. Okay. That was part of the problem.
Okay. So what haven't we learned? It was a problem then, it's a problem now. What's the disconnect?
People kind of just want to have fun, but I don't necessarily have a problem with people doing the drugs. I have a problem with the drugs doing the people.
Okay.
And people who, you know, recreational versus addiction, and people walk down a path and end up realizing that they are addicted later and kind of can't get out of it and can't deal with that. I don't know if it's strength of personality or weakness of personality, but drugs are pretty dangerous.
Pretty dangerous, but...
They're problematic in terms of a social construct. I don't say, just say no. I don't say don't do them, but having some control about them when you do them, being in safe circumstances and situations when you do them, and learning and knowing that you shouldn't be doing them all the time. And what are your other things? Do you have goals in life? Now, those are messages to others that, you know, I learned the hard way.
So when did you know you hit rock bottom? Like, when did you know this is not for me?
I was out with a girlfriend and did so much and got so high, I insulted her. We didn't have our normal levels of interaction. And I wasted $700 on a crack pipe, or what we called freebase at the time. And 2 months later, I kind of quit cold turkey.
Because of the girl or the money?
Neither.
Neither.
Because me, I was messing up my life. The only thing I was doing right at the time was finishing school. That was my last semester of my undergraduate.
Okay.
So I did that. I finished that and kind of had to get away. Other than that, health was starting to slip a little bit. I got into vitamins and, you know, that rejuvenated me because I was just burning my candle in both ends. But I could look and see that I wasn't doing anything well. Wasn't doing anything up to my capacities, that the drugs were limiting my perception on life and my engagement with it.
So you quit cold turkey?
Yeah.
No gateway, no rehab, none of that?
Yes and no. I mean, I was in California, and I decided that I needed to leave and pretty much drop everything that I was dealing with, and I had $150 and drove back to St. Louis, where my folks were, and stayed at home for a year, did substitute. I mean, I got a job and stuff while I was there, but one of the things was a lot of soul searching and just basically staying away.
Okay. Can we go deeper for Access 4?
Sure.
For a minute. How did drugs make you feel? Because I ask you that because Chaka Khan actually quoted saying she loved doing drugs. She doesn't regret it. It made her feel great. But she kind of gives the same answer like you gave. She was messing up other areas of her life. It was more than just her being affected by doing them, but she loved doing it.
Some of it I enjoyed. I mean, it heightened my senses. You know, marijuana, people get the munchies. Food tastes good, sound good. Music sounds better. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're doing, people make music, you know. And so enjoying and engaging with some aspects of life, you know, sex was greater on drugs. I mean, so... those were some of the kinds of things that I could say it makes you feel, but it burned out. I burned and stopped getting that feeling. It took a longer time to stop smoking marijuana, but, you know, getting headaches and all, just didn't feel so good anymore. The highs were highs. The sensory perceptions were were great, but that's something that I used to do, and it doesn't appeal to me so much to feel. I've had that feeling, been there, done that, ready to move on.
So do you encourage other people to get that feeling, experience it, and then move on?
No, I mean, a lot of people don't need it, don't want it, and that's good for them. I applaud them for having that. Like I said, I don't get on a moralistic, no, you shouldn't do this and this is bad, you know, to the extent that it's healthy and it's done in a healthy and safe situation and context. Too much of anything, even a good thing, is dangerous for you. So I'm saying don't overdo it when you do it, but at the same time, be sure that you take care of what you're supposed to take care of if it's recreational. If it's, you know, if you work hard all week, you deserve to be able to party and do what you need to do.
That's a dangerous message.
If people work and they're productive and they're doing stuff that they like to do, what they like to do recreationally, I'm not necessarily going to tell them no, as long as it's done safely. And that involves safety for other people, involves safety for a social situation, involves safety for their own bodies. And they have to deal with what they have to deal with illegal context. Because, see, I also see caffeine as a very addictive drug. I see nicotine as a very addictive drug. And people are dealing with those. Alcohol as a very addictive drug. So in terms of the dangerous messages, I mean, you can look around. You can see people advertising soda, people advertising, not cigarettes so much anymore, but coffee or tea, you know, as the drug of choice. My problem is how people define themselves by the drugs that they use. So
we as a society are hypocritical to a degree. We accept
some drugs. As a society, we as individual human beings, if you get to know anybody, you get to know how hypocritical they are. And it's hard for them to see it. Mm. And the same thing can be said about me.
Okay, that's fair. That's real fair. So, have you ever told this story in public before?
This is what you mean by public, not necessarily on camera, but I get to be kind of an activist about it. One of the stories that I tell, I was teaching at a university, and I just won't name the university, but sitting in the cafeteria, and it was kind of a food court sort of situation, and a couple of young ladies were talking about this guy named John, who was just this head. He was always high, and he was a stoner. They got up and went to get some dessert and came back. And I said, you know, I'm not meaning to get in your discussion because it was your discussion, but I couldn't help but hearing because I'm sitting right here next to you. Have you talked with John about this? See, because 25 years ago, I was a John. But nobody pulled my coattails and told me this is how you're being seen. Because you're just walking around in a fog and you're enjoying your life. But nobody really told me how I was being seen. Now, it may not have had an immediate effect, but if you hear the message enough, people will begin to think that they want to change. Or they'll have at least that much more data and input. So that's one of the stories that I consistently, you know, tell, that I wish somebody had, somebody's, more than once had tried to tell me how I was being perceived. Because too often we don't see people the way other people see us. And we don't know what other people are necessarily thinking about us. And that can be very good information. You know, that's one of the problems in society, and people are trying to be polite. For example, if somebody tells you your breath stinks, you may get upset about that, but you may also need a piece of gum, a toothbrush, or to see a dentist.
Yeah.
So that can be good information if you get it. Mm-hmm. And it depends on maybe how it comes out and how people deal with that. But some of the negative information are some of the best ones that we need to have. And that's where true, when you talk about love is one thing, but true friendship is something else.
Okay.
So that's the kind of way that friends, that's the kind of way that lovers would do for each other. So something's not right and you need to be able to deal with it and change it.
Okay. So you write books, correct?
I'm writing.
You're writing.
I published a couple. I published a book of poetry,
okay,
and I published an academic book that was my dissertation.
And you don't think this is a book in making?
What?
Drugs and overcoming and addiction.
It may be, but I have other creative things that I want to deal with.
Because that sounds like your Oprah book list special. Like, I think she would put you on her book club with that book.
I don't know. I teach and deal with popular culture, but I don't know if I want to be on Oprah's book list.
Everybody loves Oprah.
Okay, but I don't prefer to follow the crowd.
Okay,
just because everybody else does it, I don't necessarily want to do it. And that's, you asked me about controversy.
What is so bad with mainstream? Everything about mainstream isn't bad. Everything about popular culture is not bad.
That's true, but are you doing it because other people are doing it or because you're doing it because you want to? I make my own decisions. I try to make my own decisions, and I don't do it just because it's popular.
Okay, so name something that is popular that you can get with.
Sports.
Okay.
Sports are popular. I like that.
So who's your favorite athlete?
I have a couple. You know, so it's kind of a top 10 list. You know, it's like I think of Chris Rock, top five. You know, can't just say who's my favorite athlete. Serena Williams is up there. Martina Navratilova is up there. Cheryl Miller is up there. Willie Mays was one of my early favorites. Jim Thorpe, going back. Jesse Owens, going back. Jackie Joyner Kersee. The diversity and variety of athletes, you know, like that. The man I call the Spider, I'm forgetting his name right now. Mixed martial artist from Brazil. He's one of my favorites. So I have a lot of mm-hmm. different athletes.
Have you always talked this soft?
Yes, my name, Kemau, means quiet warrior.
Okay.
Not just talk this soft. I really don't have to talk.
I would hate to be in your class. I feel like I would have to be right up front to hear.
Well, I move around. I pay attention. I tell my students, see, if I can dish it out, I can take it. I tell them, I said, turn up the volume. I tell them, tell me the same thing. That's fine. And if I'm thinking about it, I'll be conscious about it. But if I'm not conscious about it, then I tend to speak softly. Mm-hmm. Because I'm more used to just speaking in terms of who I'm speaking to here, not looking at the mic and just dealing with an individual. I don't think you have to speak loud to do that. But in public speaking, if I was talking to a class, I can project if I need to, but that's not the voice that I prefer to use.
I'm just wondering, what is a good day to you?
Once I had an old man tell me, excuse me, I was working in a hospital and he said, any day that you have a reason to smile and you have a good shit, it's a good day. Said, you're young, boy. Said, by the time you get my age, you'll understand what I'm talking about.
And do you understand what he's talking about?
I can understand what he's talking about, but I would add a few other things in there. You know, an orgasm helps out any day. I mean, so in terms of what is a good day, I enjoy eating. A good meal helps with that. Seeing and interacting with people who laugh and smile, and if I get a chance to laugh and smile, you know, seeing a kid in a restaurant and kids looking up over the bench at me and smiling, wanting to talk, those things are things that will make my day. If I can know that I have left a positive effect, if I've left the world a better place, whether it's picking up some trash that I've done, whether it's some of the volunteer work going in, reading poetry or folklore or doing some kind of a workshop in the public schools, those are some of the kinds of things that would make a good day for me. If I also get a good hand in BitWiz and run a few Boston's on people and get a chance to talk some stuff, that'll make a good day for me too.
Okay. I want to end this interview kind of where we left off on the last interview, because a lot of people were mad at you. And I don't know if you remember what you said, because the question was, you're going to get your water for this.
Yeah, I just need to clear my throat some. Yeah, so what's up?
The question was, who do you believe is a coon? And we know what you feel about that word. You don't like that word.
Right.
But for lack of better words, you went on and answered Tyler Perry.
Yes.
We need you to expound on that. You just can't knock one of the greatest filmmakers of the Black community and think that's just where it ends.
Okay, well, greatness is our most popular.
I think he's a great filmmaker. He got a long way to go. I mean, he didn't go to school like Spike Lee, but I still think he's a great filmmaker. Okay. His writing could use some work, but that's like knocking...
Well, the characters that he presents.
Okay.
And part of it is if you have the opportunity, films that you don't produce. Because if Tyler Perry was to challenge me on that, why did I say that about him? I would say that there would be some things that he could do differently or better, and some of that is the films he chooses to make. I just saw For Colored Girls.
Excellent film.
I appreciated what he did with it in terms of the film in and of itself. The play and the choreo poem that Ndozake Shange wrote. So it was derived from that, and there were some things that I thought that the connections weren't loose, that it wasn't the best remake of the play, but as a basis and a foundation for a film making its own statement, I haven't seen anything of his that I've enjoyed.
What have you seen?
That much. Bits and pieces of things. You know, if I can't get into it, if it's a book, I get 20 or 30 pages into it and it's not moving me, I drop it and put it down. So, yeah, many the different things that I've seen have not impressed me. I don't necessarily appreciate men doing women's roles when women need to be doing their roles. Look at what Hollywood is like politically.
There it is.
That's one of the things.
Okay.
No, that's not all of it. But dealing with stereotypes and what I referred to as minstrelsy. Let's get beyond that. So you know, I saw one of his acting roles as a man where he played the James Patterson character, Cross. I saw him in that and I could appreciate kind of what he did with that, but he dropped that. And that could have been a series because Patterson has written 10, 15 books in that series, so why not make another one of those? But if he can choose to make films that he wants to make, Jubilee by Margaret Walker should be made into a film. Now, they made a film of Beloved, but Tar Baby, Song of Solomon by Toni Morrison would make excellent, excellent films. Mama Day by Gloria Naylor would make an excellent film. Other books, Temple of My Familiar, which I'm going through probably my 15th reread of that, would make a very good epic film. But people aren't making some of those kinds of films. The Cheneysville incident. When you look at a great filmmaker, are they making great films? What are the stories that are being told? How uplifting are they? How real or true are they? And how much do they diverge from stereotypes? Are they new? Are they breaking and challenging new ground? I don't necessarily see him presenting new and challenging new ground.
I think he gives a balance. I mean, if you...
A balance from what?
I've seen characters who can come off a little bit, you know, coonish.
Okay.
But I've also seen characters to where it's not the ordinary black portrayed.
Okay.
But if the stereotype is true, why go against it? Is art reflecting life, or is life reflecting art?
If you can find examples to support the stereotype, you mean rather than the stereotype is true?
I mean, you remember, I mean, you don't watch his films, so I could tell you films, but you wouldn't know what I'm talking about anyway. You've only seen one or two. I've watched all of them.
Okay, but when you say if the stereotype is true, and I'm not trying to be contentious.
You are, but no, continue.
No. If you say if the stereotype is true, is that a stereotype or is that a truth? So I don't necessarily believe the stereotypes. I think humanity is broader than whatever stereotypes they would be. So now there are commonalities. There are junkies. There are pimps. There are hoes in the black community.
Right.
There are church sisters
in the black community. And there are business people.
There are business people. There are doctors.
Yes, he shows it all. We've seen it all across the board.
I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him. Maybe I should call, maybe I should call. I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him. But I'll never call, maybe that's my flaw.